Chaddaya, other distinguished colleagues who are responsible for organizing this today for India seminar on Indian historical materialism. I would like to begin by thanking Professor Chaddaya, Dr. Gopinath and others for giving me the great privilege and honor of being here, more than to speak, be able to meet and interact with all of you here. And I must say I come here also for much needed inspiration and to recharge my soul, so that at a very, very important time in the history of our country, very, very important time in the history of our country, when frankly history will look back at this period and ask a very simple question: what was the choice made by the backward classes, scheduled caste, scheduled tribe? What strategic choices did they make for the future of this country? Because the future of this country is now in our hands. Dr. Ambedkar's constitution in which Jawaharlal Nehru had a very important role to play over the last 70 years has crippled caste supremacy in this country with two main instruments: one person, one vote, universal franchise, and reservations. These two instruments have had huge consequences, and we are in the eighth decade of our republic, and we are now coming to the end of the 16th Lok Sabha. By coincidence, the civil war of the United States took place in the eighth decade of the American Republic, and Lincoln was its 16th president. We are in the midst of a civil war. United States Constitution in 1787 also wrote, all men are created equal. And in the Philadelphia Convention, they deliberately decided a group of white men to exclude from that category black African slaves and even their own women. When it was put to them, they said, no, all men are created equal, all white men are created equal. And very few people know that the night before he was shot, after the Civil War was successfully concluded, a few people gathered in the White House in the evening and Lincoln came out informally and spoke to them in candlelight. It was dark. And in that speech, in the order, he said, I want the slaves to have the right to vote. His assassin was in the crowd. And eyewitnesses said, his assassin said, this is the last speech this man will make. And he killed him the next day. We are also in the eighth decade of our independence. White supremacy had been crippled by the American Constitution. There was a backlash. And the question in the 8th century was, will the Shudras of America, America is a Shudra country. Marx hailed Lincoln as a son of the working class. Karl Marx himself was an admirer of Lincoln. It was the white working class that fought and created a new republic, and many scholars say that the republic that emerged in the United States after the 1861 to 65 Civil War was a new republic. It was a second republic based on equality and freedom. So the white working class, which were the majority of the working class in that country, fought for the equality and freedom of a population that was smaller than our SCST population. 2% of the country was killed much of the physical property was destroyed. Why? To fight for equality for their equivalent of their ballots. The white privileged, white supremacist plantation owners were not going to fight for the freedom of the Dalits or the equality of the Dalits. The caste, Savarna supremacists of India are not going to fight for the freedom and equality of anybody in this country. So I am a great admirer of Professor Kancha for the last two decades. It is my, not my eighth decade, my third decade of being his follower and admirer. But he is right in focusing on the working class of India. When he says Shudra, he is at heart and at the beginning a Marxist. He is talking of the working class, means literally those who produce, those who work. And it is, the future is in our hands. If the white working class of America had not been prepared to sacrifice a lot for the equality of everyone in that country, then today America would not have been a superpower. The secret weapon of America is freedom and equality. That's what gives them strength. There are many weaknesses, but if they have any strength, it is freedom and equality for everyone. And so to have this meeting here today, to meet all of you, gives me great hope and great inspiration that we will come together. We are engaged in this battle because I believe that the central challenge facing India, the only thing holding this country back and chaining in poverty more people than in any country in the world today, in subhuman poverty and subhuman conditions, is only one thing. It is a refusal of the Hindu upper caste, particularly the North Indian Hindu upper caste, to democratize the Hindu social order. This is a struggle. Can we democratize the Hindu social order? The vast majority of Hindus are treated as inferior. By who? By a small minority, not of everyone who is born into any of the upper caste, but a small minority of upper class vested interests are refusing to change the Hindu social order. That's why I picked up this book. We all know this writing, but I picked it up because it is put together as a small booklet. Dr. Ambedkar focused our attention on the Hindu social order. The struggle is to democratize it, reformulate its foundation on the basis of freedom and equality and fraternity and dignity. Right now, the Hindu social order's foundation is inequality. It is hierarchy. It is superiority. We celebrate today, this year in 2018, as one century after Narayana Guru is said in Kerala, something very, very profound. When he was asked, he said there is no caste. But he said, yes, religion is a reality. And he was asked, what about Hinduism? And he said, there is no such thing as a Hindu religion. Something worth thinking about. Because it is not a religion. It is a political movement. As we now know it. But I very much understand and appreciate the question that was asked, sir, or comment that was made by you, that this so-called Hindu religion, which we also know from Akshay Mukul's Gita Press and the construction of the Hindu social order, was constructed in the 19th century, although Narayana Guru declared that, like Gandhi said, there is no such thing as Western civilization, but would not say that there is no such thing as Hindu social order, Hindu religion. Narayana Guru said, no, there is no such thing as a Hindu religion in the 20th century. But Akshay Mukul explains how in the 19th century this was constructed as a political project to fill the vacuum left behind by the demise of the Mughals and the British. After the First War of Independence in 1857, it became clear to some people that both the Kshatriyas and the British have been so wounded that they will not recover. And so a vacuum is emerging. So the Brahmin Banya classes that worked for the Mughals and the British said, okay, we are going to fill this vacuum. And instead of working for these British or for the Brahmins, sorry, or for the Kshatriyas, the Brahmin and Banya will come together and rule this country. And that is what we are seeing today basically going on in our country. And they have constructed a nation and a religion to facilitate this project, to counter this ideology. So we have talked, when we talk of my topic someone mentioned to me at interested to see what I'm going to say, because it's a very delicate topic, which it is, but I will speak frankly about it. This is Indian judiciary and Brahminism. I'm just setting the background to it. But this project that if one or two communities will take power, fill this vacuum, is a very significant fact for us to bear in mind, because they constructed this around, ironically, religion, Hinduism, an economic system that they constructed, and also around modernity and English, as Professor Kacha constantly reminds us. They used these ideas to construct, as a political project, the ideology of Brahminism, which is not really about individuals. We are not, none of us are here today to attack a community, to attack any individual, to attack anything. We are here to question the ideologies that are holding back our country. And certainly, Brahminism is an idea, it's a political project, an ideology that some people are born to rule, created by God to rule. And others are inferior and are to be ruled and to be supplicants, to be looked after, to be given the breadcrumbs of power. This ideology of inherent superiority, which cannot be altered in this world, in this life. This ideology strongly emerged in this country as a ruling ideology, as Akshay Mukul shows in his book, after the collapse of both the Kshatriyas and the British, to fill that vacuum. I am very happy to say that it was countered by the constitutional ideology that was a combination of Ambedkar's own philosophy and theorizing about India based on the realities of caste, the social realities which we all live on a day-to-day basis, as well as Nehru's Marxist framework of class. Then powerfully came together and created a very progressive, extraordinary ideology which was established in our constitution. And that constitutional ideology started to counter this political project of Brahminism. And I am happy to say that starting from my state in Kerala, if you work northwards, in the south of this, certainly in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, Brahminism has been defeated. And think that we are still fighting Brahminism. No, it has been defeated, certainly in these two states, substantially. In the other South Indian states, now three of them, it has been weakened, substantially weakened, and cannot come back. That's why I said the real fight is now in the north. And the refusal of the Brahminical forces in north of India to democratize the Hindu society is threatening to destroy this country. They are prepared to destroy the country rather than democratize Hinduism. Best case scenario, 100 years from now, thanks to the support and concern of a global community, most Christians and most Muslims will improve their condition. But India will still be poor so long as the Hindu social order is not reformed, because the North Indian Hindu Dalits will not be allowed and given the space to escape the social system, because without their subjugation, there is no Brahminism, there is no Brahmin, there is no upper caste. It is essential to have Brahmin supremacy to create and maintain the subordinated class. So this is the challenge that we have. And the instrument we have to meet this challenge is our constitutional ideology. Now I also want to briefly say that Professor Kancha pointed out that I am a follower of Narayana Guru. And the right-wing forces are not afraid of us compared to the Dalits. He's right. But please understand that Kerala is the place where the BJP and the RSS, the right-wing forces, have had the greatest difficulty to penetrate. So whatever Narayana Guru did has produced amazing results. The left movement in Kerala, the footprint of the left movement in Kerala is Narayana Guru's footprint. You go 10 kilometers outside Kerala into Tamil Nadu and Narayana Guru did not work, there is no Marxist movement there. Where Narayana Guru worked, there is a left movement. Why? Because the left movement is nothing more than a political face of the social movement of Narayana Guru. Kerala was lucky because we had a combination of a progressive social movement and a progressive political movement. In Bengal, they had a progressive political movement, but not the, a similar type of progressive social movement. In Tamil Nadu, we had a progressive social movement, but not a really progressive political movement. Kerala was very, very lucky that we first had in the 19th century an extraordinarily theoretical, Professor Kancha keeps emphasizing, and I'm hoping for the day that he'll include Narayana Guru as a great philosopher. Simply because he's not read in English doesn't mean he's not significant. English is not significant in this country, frankly. But so Narayana Guru created a progressive movement, and his own followers and his own movement really built the Marxist movement and Marxist party in Kerala. So we had a very sound Marxist theory on how to organize economic production, which Narayana Guru did not have. But we also had a very sound theoretical framework on how to organize society, which Marx did not have, but Narayana Guru had. So when these two things came together, Kerala has improved its material condition better than any other part of this country. And so that's why the BJP is not afraid of me, because they have given up on us. They really cannot. And if you go to the Malayalam website of Modi, it seems like you're reading a very progressive leftist website. They cannot. The BJP candidate who contested in Malappuram and lost very badly, one of his election promises, I'm told by the media, I've read in the media, was that if he's elected, he will ensure that beef is supplied at high quality and low price. I have many pictures with me of in Trivandrum of in the prom, most prominent parts of Trivandrum, there's a board, beef. I have a picture of Professor Kancha Ilaya eating in a restaurant in Trivandrum with a big sign announcing it's beef. And no, none of these right-wing forces will dare to protest against that. So we can learn from the strength of these ideologies we have. We're very lucky in this country to have Ambedkar, Periyar, Pule, Narayana Guru, Nehru, the Marxist thinkers, EMS, A.K. Gopalan, so many wonderful thinkers who have created a number of ideas and frameworks for us to move forward. So it is in this context, I think, a more optimistic context, that we are in the eighth decade of our independence. We know from the American experience that 7 decades of a constitution that promises but does not deliver equality has a huge impact and usually leads to civil war. And we are having a civil war. And what we are having, frankly, is a Hindu civil war. But this hero of mine, Mr. Rohit Bemula, and his family died for was to democratize the Hindu social order, demanding equality, demanding dignity, demanding respect, demanding, as Martin Luther King said, I am human. Recognize me as a human being. So we are in a moment where there is a backlash. We are standing up. Nowhere in this country, and we all travel to different parts of the country, does any poor person even remotely believe anymore that he is inferior to anybody or she is inferior to anybody. That is gone. No one even says that to them. Some of the upper castes may believe that they are superior, but they will not say this openly anymore. Why? Not because they don't want to, but the environment has changed. So now the issue is how do we move forward? And Professor Kancha has laid out certain parts which are, I think, very, very important for us to think about. But now let me turn very briefly to the issue of the judicial system and Brahmanism, because this is the background in which I wanted to speak about it. See, what is the judiciary? You know all this, but I'm just making an argument. I'm not saying it because you don't know, but I just want to construct an argument. The word judiciary and judge and justice comes from the root word J-U-S, use. J-U-S, use. Use means, you all know, the right norm, the right value of conduct, of human conduct.
Which language?
In Latin. Latin. Use. So, if you look at all definitions of justice, Rawls said justice is fairness, right? It is about how human beings treat each other. All theories of justice are about human conduct towards each other. So if this light falls on my head, unless there is a human intervention, there is no issue of law of justice. It is an electrical failure or something, suppose an insect ate something and it fell, the wire, or the mouse ate the wire and it fell, then I can't go to court to sue the mouse. So justice, I argue, very simple thing, so sometimes difficult to understand, to comprehend because it's so simple. Justice is a standard of human conduct. Now the Indian judiciary and the Indian legal system is the only judiciary or legal system in the world whose mandate is defined in the constitution itself. And no other branch of the Indian state has its mandate defined in the constitution. That's in Article 39A. And it says that the state shall ensure that the operation of the legal system promotes justice on the basis of equal opportunity. So promote justice is the mandate of the judiciary and the legal system. Justice is a standard of human conduct, the right standard of human conduct. The standard of right human conduct, not wrong human conduct, that is justice. So the mandate of the judiciary is to promote the right standard of human conduct. The standard of right human conduct, correct human conduct. and punishment, conviction are instruments for that. Law is a set of rules that will promote the right standard of human conduct. So if I tell a child, be good, then I say, don't hit somebody, don't use bad language. These are rules, that's like law. Be a good child is a standard of human conduct, that is justice. So, in this context, the role of the judiciary is very clear. Promote human conduct that is correct and use the instruments given to you of basically civil liabilities. So if you take the Indian Evidence Act, it says very beautifully, it says, and once I'm talking about the Indian Evidence Act, I'll just briefly make a detour to talk about materialism there. It very beautifully says it is to establish the existence, non-existence, nature or extent of right, liability or disability. Why do you give a right or impose liability or disability? To promote the right conduct amongst human beings through that. Now, the question is, if this is the job of the judiciary, what is the definition of right human conduct? Who defines it? So, in the ancient Brahminical state, so I say, legally speaking, there are three phases in the Indian judicial system. Raja eras, Brahminical rule. Raj era is the British rule. Swaraj era is constitutional rule. So the role of the judge in the Raja era was Dushta Danda Sajana Puja Rajya Kosha Vriddhi Rajya Raksha. Dushta Danda Sajana Raksha Kosha Vriddhi Rajya Raksha. Nothing to do about promoting the right standard of conduct. Why? Because the right standard of conduct was what they decided was the right standard of conduct. So Dushta, who is the Dushta and who is the Sajan? Whoever does not follow their standard of conduct. What is the most important power of democracy? Democracy comes from the word kratos. Kratos means authority. Demos means common people. Kratos, power and authority is in the hands of demos, common people. That is democracy.
That's Greek.
Sorry?
That's Greek. Greek.
Yeah, that's Greek.
Yeah.
Now the most important part of democracy is that common people will decide what is right conduct and what is wrong conduct. Not the Brahmins, but the Dalits. When the Brahmins had the power to decide what was, the Brahminism had the power to decide what was right conduct and wrong conduct. What was wrong conduct for a Dalit to not maintain distance from the Brahmin? To let his shadow fall on the Brahmin. And of course, to rob or injure an upper caste is unthinkable. We should not let the new generation forget about the realities of the Chaturvarnya system. It is never talked about. Why is it that the Jewish people constantly remind the world about what happened in Germany? The Holocaust of the Jews. The Holocaust of the Avarnas shall not be forgotten. If a Ram temple is built in Ayodhya, there must be a memorial to the victims of casteism for generations in that Ram temple. So when they could decide what is right conduct and wrong conduct, we know. I don't have to tell you what was defined as right conduct and wrong conduct. But democracy now took that power away from them and put it in the hands of the poorest Dalit and said, you will define what is right conduct and wrong conduct. And the Dalit was the chairman of the Grafti committee and he said, What is wrong conduct to take away somebody's equality? To take away somebody's freedom? To take away somebody's dignity? That is wrong conduct. That idea of a wrong conduct of justice will never come from a Brahmanist judiciary. It has never come. We've had a Brahmanist judiciary for centuries. Never produced it. But this constitution has changed that. One thing we tend to forget is there is no automatic, axiomatic relationship between a constitution and democracy and freedom, or independence of judiciary and democracy and freedom, or equality. There are many countries in the world which has constitution and constitutionalism. Constitutionalism is simply the idea that all governance shall be conducted in accordance with a constitution. But the constitution can prescribe the authoritarian dictatorship and can be used as a basis to take away equality and freedom. Similarly, independent judiciary, we had an independent judiciary when the British were ruling us. So what is crucial, what gives us our democracy, our freedom, our equality, is the ideological content of the constitution. If that ideological content is changed, we will have no democracy, no freedom, no equality. Constitution will still be there. So today, I'm half an hour, I'll stop in 5-7 minutes and then we'll have a discussion. Today the main attempt is two sets of ideologies are attacking the ideological content of the constitution to hollow out the constitution but keep it there. So it is not enough for us to say let us defend the constitution. We have to say let us defend the ideology of the constitution. And we must become acquainted very closely with the ideology of that constitution. Reservations, equality, freedom, liberty, social welfare, a welfare state, socialism, secularism. One of the most important, this is where I said I'll make a small detour, beautiful definitions of secularism is the definition of fact in the Indian Evidence Act. Very powerful definition of fact. It says only that is a fact which based on material, proved fact, which on the basis of material placed before a court, a court believes it to be true, which is capable, a fact is only a fact which is capable of being perceived by the senses or the consciousness of a person. That definition of the Evidence Act says that nothing that cannot be perceived by the senses exists. Which means basically, from the legal perspective, God does not exist. So how can, on what basis can a truly modern court deal with the myth, the religious myth? They cannot. So the Evidence Act and modernity is dictating, this is secularism, that nothing but what can be perceived by senses shall be taken into account as a fact by the Indian state. Two, as a basis of imposing right, liability or disability. So this framework, this ideology has to be the fine print of this ideology has to be protected and not one part of it can be allowed to be altered or changed. Then we will protect the soul of the constitution, not just the formality of a constitution which can easily be hollowed out. So one attack is by the Hindu rational idea, which is opposed to democracy, opposed to, if you read Mr. Punyani knows very well, you read more better than me, the writings of Golwalkar or Savarkar, they explicitly say monarchy is better than democracy, equality is wrong, democracy is wrong, freedom is wrong, all these things are wrong. So that ideology wants to overthrow the ideological content of the constitution even by keeping it there and destroy this republic. The second is neoliberalism. Neoliberalism wants to, the Hindu Rashtra concept wants to destroy the social ideology of the constitution. Neoliberal and the political ideology of the constitution of democracy. Neoliberalism wants to destroy the economic ideology of the constitution, which is socialism and the welfare state. And these two have common ground, they're coming together to hollow out the constitution and destroy this republic. Now here, this is the last point I want to make, second last point I want to make, is where we have to recognize the truth that has been recognized all over the world, but we still pretend that it is not the truth. The truth is that judges have their own political ideology as human beings. That's why we are seeing in the United States is the only country that fully recognizes it. We are having this week, as we have been going on, a nomination of a new judge to the Supreme Court, one of 9 judges. And what is being debated is the ideology of this man and his personal conduct, but both. So we all know that consciously or subconsciously, not always consciously, there is an ideology. Now I do agree that a judge normally should not be, and my own experience working with a large number of judges is that consciously most of them are not casteist. They are not, as individuals, they are not partisan in terms of wanting to support X party or Y party. They are very conscious of the fact that they are judges and they must have decisional independence and neutrality. But what they don't realize is they're not capable of that as human beings. Our psychology and our biology prevent us from being independent. So I don't want to name a one very distinguished judges in this country, now retired, once told me, when I put on a gown, I'm not Mr. So and so, I'm a judge. I told him, I said, the gown may change the way you look, but it does not change who you are. Now these are, let us take the best intention people, not the worst intention people. They cannot overcome their bias. They may be a good bias, they may be a bad bias. I have my bias. All of us have our ideology and our bias. So how do we respond to that? We respond to that in two ways. One is by building a very detailed methodology of how to judge and how judges should decide, which we have not yet done in this country, but we are trying to do now. So that the methodology becomes very clear, so that the, like a scientist, much more than now happens, there's less subjectivity, less arbitrariness, and a methodology of evaluating evidence, of analysis, the reasoning, the transparency of reasoning, of logic, the concepts of logic, reasoning, facts, the recognition of fact I told you, all this should be combined to produce a counter to the prejudice and bias, human prejudice and bias that judges have, the tides that affect all human beings. So then what do? In addition to the methodology, we must make sure that the judiciary is fully representative of this country. And people from ordinary, common, non-privileged backgrounds should be in the Supreme Court, in the High Courts, in all the judiciary of the country. People who are working with their own hands, who know the actual realities. In fact, I was very happy, I thought of you, Professor Panjar, very happy to see, I think it was Maharashtra, a retired judge. He went back and instead of taking a fancy post-retirement government job, he went back to being a farmer. So he's sitting with his lungi and his turban and all that on his tractor, and he's farming. And they put a picture of that. So he's done what you're saying. He's gone back to producing agricultural production. So people like that, and there are people like that, but we need more people like that who are representative of the common experience of people in this country, which means we must demand we have reservations in the subordinate courts in some states in our country. We must have that in all states, and we must also have representation of women and representation of all castes and communities in the judiciary, which is today largely male upper caste Hindu, and therefore has a certain bias. Now the implication of this is also important, because if these two ideologies want to alter the constitute the ideology of the constitution, they cannot do it through amendment of the constitution or repealing and re-enacting the constitution. There will be massive resistance in this country. So the only way they can do it is through interpretation of the constitution by courts. And that's how they're doing it. We saw that with the SCST Atrocities Act. That's a Chinnapareddy of Andhra Pradesh, a great judge. He wrote a book on Summit and Shadows of the Constitution before he passed away. And in that book he has said, he has called the 50% limit on reservations as unconstitutional. So they put 50% reservation limit. They're altering the constitution, and you need only 5 or 6 people to alter this, the ideology of the constitution. And this, the whole idea of limiting the power of parliament to alter the constitution, these are all ideas that have come from the judiciary. So we need to ensure that we must democratize the judiciary and the judicial system, and make it representative of the people and the masses of this country. And we must also, as I said at the beginning, reject the false idea, the false belief that judges don't have, at the level of ideology, not at the level of prejudice, neutrality. They don't. Which means we must have judges who are committed not to party, not to individuals, not to particular partisan interests, but to the ideology of the constitution. After all, they take an oath in which they say they have faith in the constitution. Faith in the constitution means what? Faith in the ideology of the constitution. So we have to examine every candidate who is appointed to the judiciary. If they are against reservations, they should never be made a judge of any court in this country, because reservation is a part of the constitution of India. We cannot have a judge who will sit there and say, and rule against reservation. His job is to protect and fight and strengthen reservation, not to destroy it. So we must rethink the way the judges are appointed. There was a recent book written by, again, people who don't share the same ideology, but I was asked to review it for EPW. I've just written the review. It will come. But I said this, that the ideology of the judges must be taken into account, otherwise we will lose our constitution through judicial interpretation. There are a couple of other things, I think, which going forward we need to focus on. I think we need to democratize the executive. The executive and the judiciary were copy-pasted from the 1935 Act, unlike the legislature, and they still retain a very colonial structure. I have been many times to the Masoodi Academy. They take ordinary human beings and convert them into believing that they are superior people simply because they passed an examination. And then they are sort of entitled and licensed and capable of ruling all of us. So we have to really attack these feudal ideologies that still exist in the executive branch. We have to democratize the judiciary in terms of its process, its appointments, its internal culture, which is still extremely feudal also. And a lot of work, to be fair to the judges, they are receptive to this, and a lot of work and thinking, at least consciousness, is coming up there. We need to revitalize democracy in politics by having inner party democracy and much more vibrant democracy. Now, parties are getting democratizing simply by splitting and forming new parties. But we must ensure that it remains, that politics is not captured by power brokers, which is what has happened now. That is a big danger to the constitution. They have no ideological commitment. They will also sell out the constitution to the rich and the powerful. The media must be democratized. We must have reservations in the media. There was a policy, at least as a voluntary policy, there was a conscious policy. I talk of the United States simply because everybody is familiar with it and it's easy to talk about it. It's not at all a perfect country. There's still a lot of racism and bad things there. But some good things to point out. In the 70s, they took a policy decision that every newsroom, prominent newsroom, news broadcast must have African Americans. Minorities. So you find now all the newsrooms have African Americans because it's a matter of conscious policy. Similarly, we must insist that the media must say that 70% of their editors, 80% of their anchors must be from OBC or CST. If we have to watch them, if not, we will not be able to watch them in a way that reflects the realities of our country. Academia must be democratized. As we go forward, and you all know that very well. We are sitting in a university. Universities are also run by small, powerful sort of groups. We have to democratize that, and it's not the time to talk about that. I'm just mentioning these few ideas, and I think. The key challenge is, I think, to understand that we have something to defend here. The ideology of our constitution and the idea of our republic. That is what has brought us forward. We have to, as Professor Kancha said, further develop it, build on it, strengthen it, give it, bring in new ideas moving forward. And develop new theory. And one of the new theories is we have to find a new way of understanding, and I'll end with this, Hinduism. Because we cannot dismiss the kind of idea, Professor Kancha, that was expressed in the question and answer session. But in fact, see, and we just said, I want to say, I'll pose this question, why is the Hindu Kush mountain named Hindu Kush? From very ancient times, and we were told that we are all called Hindus because the Arabs could not, the Persians could not pronounce S. Although S is in the middle of Islam. So I don't know why they can say S for Islam.
S at initial part, basically.
No, but that's not. Salman is their name, Salahuddin is their name. The S is everywhere. They don't have a P as in, like in Gopal, P. They have only a B. But S is, so that's not correct. Why is the Hindu Kush range called the Hindu Kush? Now, if you research it, you'll find that one of the explanations, I'm not saying it's correct, but the only explanation I have seen is that Kush means killer. So Hindu Kush mountains were called Hindu Kush because it means Hindu killer. Now, what is Hindu there? Apparently, the word Hindu refers to the dark, it means black and dark people. So the people who are living in today's Afghanistan, Pakistan and those areas, native to those areas, they faced the Hindu Kush mountains. And they saw on the other side of Hindu, of this, these mountains, are Hindus, these black and dark people. And the explanation I read is that sometimes these people would go, these were peaceful tribal people who believed in what Professor Kancha called spiritual democracy, I call spiritual anarchy, which is what I am, a spiritual anarchist. I have the freedom to believe that this is my God and nobody can question that. And Brahmanism and these other organized religions, Islam, Christianity, are all telling me what I should believe, but I am a spiritual anarchist, right? So these peaceful spiritual anarchists living on the other side, some of them were caught and brought as slaves. But when they were brought through these mountains, they died. But they could not survive the cold. And that's why these mountains are called Hindu Kush mountains. Now this means that we are the real Hindus. I'm saying in this interpretation, we are the real Hindus. If it means dark and black and so on. And there are people who are not so dark and black, who are from that region, who at some point colonized us. And as was suggested, maybe came down, they really didn't have as wonderful and colorful and spiritual anarchy like intellectual anarchy produces fantastic results. Great inventions, great science. All this great science we are seeing in the West came from sort of anarchic thinking, which refused to, what was Galileo, he refused to think within the box. You know, so he said, no, no, what you're saying is wrong, right? So these people came and discovered amazing ideas, amazing philosophy. So there are scholars who say, Ramayana, Mahabharata, you say that Krishna and Rama are Aryan because they are mentioned in the Ramayana, Mahabharata. But there are scholars who argue that these documents are simply taking the stories of the local Hindus and writing them up. So naturally they would figure there because it was not their stories. And what they brought with them, as he pointed out, did not survive. Most of it did not survive. But they have been very, very effective without reforming the Hindu theology, the Hindu belief system. That's what Narayana Guru fundamentally did in Kerala. He reformed Hindu theology and Hindu ritual, sacrament, how you pray, who prays. So, and he said, anyone can pray, you don't need a priest. So without these reforms, we cannot go forward. So we need also a great intellectual effort to come up with our own understanding and approach, because a lot of people here own this religion. This is their religion. We cannot take it away from them. It has been already once stolen from them. We cannot steal it again. We have to protect it. So we have to theorize it based on their religion, respect for their heritage, their history, their sentiment of the common people in this country, and truly democratize Hindu theology and the Hindu social order. So we have a wonderful challenge of democratizing various aspects of our life, including the judiciary, and the need to democratize the judiciary is to ensure that its role of defining what is right conduct and wrong conduct is drawn not from Brahminist ideology, but from the ideology of the constitution. That is our goal in reforming the judiciary. Let me stop here and take any questions. And so we must have a much more serious process to select. What it should be, we should debate. Maybe we should have many debates around the country where people should say how do they want to select the judges. But it should not be by party leaders, there should not be a winner. It should be democratic.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So I agree with you, the last part of your lecture regarding, can we believe that the so-called symbols of gods, goddesses, beliefs, customs and whatnot, all these spiritual cultural aspects have originated themselves among people and they were transmitted across the generations, not created by any single individual. So can we believe that there were already these indigenous symbols very popular among people across India and the continent, not to the south, various forms, which were later just picked up by this foreign invaders, so-called the Brahmin, Arya Brahmins, and they just intelligently using these symbols, replacing the original ideology with their hegemonic technology. So that is just like, let me give you a very simple example of they are trying to overcome, even Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, even during the 21st century, they use very effectively this photograph among Dalits and Mohans. They preach the complete Arya Brahmin philosophy as if Ambedkar endorsed the philosophy. And there are many among us, including very educated, we are from the camp innocently, unknowingly. I think this is the same, it is the only strategy the Arya Brahminists as implemented for the past 3500 years since 1500 BC,
let the questions be brief, sir.
Yeah, just, yes, sir. Just,
we are in front of
half a minute. So all these socio-spiritual religious things which are
very good question, sir, and you have formulated the answer yourself, and I've learned from you. Your explanation is very, very good.
Yes, sir. The Hindus are, we are Hindus, not the Anabrahmins.
That's what I'm saying, sir. I mean, according to the, so what we have been, why is the Hindu Kush mountain called Hindu Kush mountain? This is my question. For a very long time, much before any of this, you know, it's called the Hindus. So that means we are the Hindus. You know, if that is correct, then we are the Hindus.
So,
but what I want to say, sir, is that if you take the history of Christianity, for the first 237 years, it was simply a wonderful non-violent spiritual movement of the wonderful theology of Jesus Christ. And then it became so powerful and popular that it started to affect the Romans, and then Constantine comes and takes over that religion and converts it. And you know, suddenly the cross, instead of being a symbol of suffering of the poorest people in the country, becomes a sign of power, you know, in the hands of Constantine. So I think a lot of people have and continue to use religion as a very powerful source of political power. And that's, in my view, that's why I said Brahminism is a political project. It is not a religious project or a social project. I agree with that. And so therefore they have used all these tactics to advance a political project. My submission to you is the 1950 constitution and the mass struggle of the people that led to that constitution for more than 100 years has defeated that ideology. Now we have to ensure that the last finishing touches are made by ensuring that the new ideology, which is the ideology of the people, democratic people, is diffused through all aspects of our state and all aspects of our life. Democracy is not just voting every 5 years. It is diffusing the idea that all power, and by the way, this is said in the 8th paragraph Objectives Resolution of the Indian Constituent Assembly, drafted by Nehru, which says, what has most important principle, all power and authority of independent India and its organs shall be derived from the people. This is the cardinal principle, and I've argued that it must be part of the basic structure of the Indian Constitution, if there is a basic structure. So every aspect of our life, any policy, public policy decision that is made, political in nature, legal in nature, must be derived from the people demonstrably. That's what we have to achieve in the next generation. And I think we will do that. I'm very optimistic that people like you, we will do that. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll just hear one very quick comment and then. Yes, yes, sir.
Sir, I want to add something to this point.
Yes, sir.
The word sudras came from sutras to Maitri, which when they have segregated the caste, they have clearly mentioned, they themselves have accepted that sutras are means the roots of this nation,
yes,
the natives of this nation. Means they themselves have said that they came from other place. There is one particular point, yes, that I want to
thank you, sir.
Means our elders should focus, and we should use it as that means the example, means the logic that they themselves have accepted. Sutras are the natives of this land.
I thank you for that point. My submission is, let us not define ourselves by how others look at us. We don't need their certificates.
Yes.
We just look at, see, there is a biological marker. You and I look the way we look because this geography has sculpted us, sir. This geography. We look like this because it is giving us camouflage. Predators will not eat us. That's why we have this color, the sun, the rain, the trees, you know, we are, you know, so we don't need any evidence or certificate from anyone that we are sons of the soil.
Yes.
We are sculpted by the geography of this land.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So,
one more.
So, sir, if I, for, yes, sir, very quickly. The other quick point I want to make is, we should stop using the word caste. Let us talk of varna and jati. We, as Dr. Ambedkar has done elaborately in Annihilation of Caste, varna is the oppressive political idea that was imposed on us. Chaturvarnya, varna vyavastha. Jati is very organic. We have all kinds of jati. Jati is like family, small, big, micro, changing, dynamic. That's ours. Right? So I have no difficulty with Nambudri, Iyer, Iyengar, because jatis, they hate each other, many of them. They will not talk to each other.
We have to remind
But the Varna, Brahman, is a political idea. It is a political idea. It is not a religious idea. And therefore, it has to be nullified, neutralized. It has no place in a democracy. So we have to annihilate Varna. And stop talking about it. Just be this. Be Narayana Guru said, don't think caste, don't talk caste. We recognize it. It has no validity. We don't need any proof. We know the. See, now the constitution has given us the power to set history, set law, set norms. Let us use that power and do it. So, one of the questions here was can we have a referendum? We can decide to have a referendum. We have a movement, we demand for it, we'll have a referendum. We're not going to let anyone, a set of wise people or judges or MPs decide whether we have a referendum. We will decide if we have a referendum. The constitution gives us that power. So let's ask the people. So that's my point, sir.
Another one is, Baba, we are the war prisoners. See, if you see the, if we compare the civilizations like Greece,
Sir, my humble submission to you, sir, is, let us get away from this victim mentality. This is our landscape. Our forefathers have fought great battles to give us a constitution that has a new ideology of equality and freedom. And many people ask me, what is equality? Because some are better or some are worse. And I define equality in a very simple way. You and I are equal. Not because we have different demonstrable, visible capability. We are equal because we both have equal but unknown potential.
I am trying to instill the confidence among our people, but as we were the rulers of this nation.
Sir, we don't want to be rulers. We are by the tradition of spiritual anarchy. We have now won our right for ourselves. We have freedom, we have equality. Let us exercise that power to construct a new society, sir. That's what the constitution wants us to do.
Just 1 minute.
Yes.
And I think you are a right person to answer that.
Yes.
Today, the Jats, Patels, Marathas, Gujars, Nakis,
yes,
where our saying is the problem,
yes,
are asking for reservation.
Yes.
And the Supreme Court, which imposed 50%, is a Brahmin imposition.
Yes.
Right? They have to overcome. Now, Patel, Jats, Marathas did not establish a common identity like Dalit.
Yes.
The Shudra is only possible identity that one can go
yes.
through or work out and all. Now, how do we overcome this problem? Are they not right when they ask for reservation? And should not we overcome this Brahmanic 50% gap by organizing them into a common ideological force and struggle? That's the problem.
Very, very, very important question, sir. My submission is the following. I think one of the challenges, I didn't have time, I wanted to talk about it, I have not briefly mentioned it. One of the big challenges we have, so the Nayas are trying to say they are really Kshatriya, the Yadavs are trying to say we are really Kshatriya. The bottom line, see, the four Varnas, the fourth Varna, as we all know, is Shudra. They are part of the Chaturvarnya system. People like us are outside it, we are Avarnas. We are Pancha, all of us are Panchamas. We are not Shudras. So we are trying, if we make an alliance with people who are inside the Chaturvarnya structure, they've already been part of it. Now their idea is to kick out the number 1, 2 and 3 and become the number 1. And then make us their followers. But that ideology will still be maintained by them. So if we give them reservations, they will use reservations to come to power and rule us. Whereas we come from a tradition of spiritual anarchy and spiritual democracy. Our main problem is we don't want to rule anyone, we don't want to be ruled by anybody. We want freedom, we want independence. We want others to have freedom and others to have independence. So ideologically we are different. So these these people who accepted the lowest position in the Chaturvarnya system. This is all political recognition. If you take EMS Namudri part and you take it, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Kashmiri Pandit, they don't look like they come from the same genetic background, right? But they're both Brahmins. Why? Because EMS Namudri part came from the same family background, same background as all of us, but that family somehow got accommodated into the Chaturvarnya system and declared to be a recognized as a Brahmin, like promoted IAS officers and all that. They got a status, right? But once they get that, they get a vested interest in that. So I think we have to give a choice to these Shudras. Are you against the ideology of rule and subjugation and subordination and hierarchy? If you are, fine, come with us. Fight that battle to restore India to the ancient system of there being democracy. As Dr. Ambedkar said in his November 25, 1949 speech, there was a time when India had a great democracy. Our constitution and his constitution and our effort is to take us back to that democracy. And these Shudras who are part of that project, they are welcome. If they are not part of that project, then we cannot allow them to use Ambedkar's reservations to subjugate us. And they are, in some states, they are using that. They are getting power and they are subordinating and subjugating everyone else and simply trying to prove themselves to be, they're spending money on research to prove their Kshatriyas and so on. So that's why I'm saying we forget all this and we move forward to a new society. Sir, only two quick points. One is contempt of court and treason. Is it not anti-democracy? I agree, it is anti-democracy. It is anything that is not violent, well recognized all over the world, should be allowed, should be permitted. Anything short of violence. So your freedom can be restrained only if it interferes with someone else's freedom. So yes, these are colonial laws that a democracy should not have. And one of our responsibility now is to really proselytize and spread democracy, the culture of democracy in every aspect. And part of that is to get rid of these laws from our law books. But without there being a change of this elite oligarchy ruling us, it will not happen. So yes, I agree with this question. What would be the role of an Indian in strengthening the ideology of the constitution is exactly what I said. We must understand it in detail, every provision of the constitution, and we must spread it through all aspects of our life, including in our own homes. The way we treat our women, the way we treat our children must be democratic, must be based on equality and freedom. If we have patriarchy in our homes, we cannot go outside our homes and demand democracy in the public space. So the spirit of equality, the spirit of freedom, the spirit of dignity must become truly internalized in our lives, and respect for everyone. As I said, equality being a recognition of the infinite potential in every human being that is equal, regardless of their economic or social condition. That is what we must recognize as the basis of equality. My time is done, it's exactly 1:15.
Sorry? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. The judiciary is like a knife or a sword. It depends on who holds it and what purpose it is used for.
And what is alternate?
So therefore, what swings the judiciary for the people? I agree with you. Judiciary is used generally for the powerless against the powerless to protect the powerful. We must turn it and use it to protect the powerless against the powerful. To do that, we need an ideology. The judiciary's swing is driven by the ideology of the constitution or the ruling ideology. What Ambedkar has given us is a ruling ideology which is very pro-people. Many parts of it, part 3, part 4, preamble, very, very strongly protecting the people. that ideology can and must be used like it was used by Krishnaya, who was a Brahmin, but not a Brahminist. He belonged to a particular varna, but he was not a Brahminist. And he used that that ideology to give huge advantages to all of us. So therefore, I think the emphasis on ideology. We must get people like you must become judges, and you must use that constitution and that ideology to protect the people and their freedom and their rights. And that is possible. And that's what I mean by saying we must democratize the judiciary.
The majority, on behalf of the majority judges in Izzasani case, Justice Jagan Mohan Reddy said that the 50% is not the bar exactly. What he said is subjected to the specific reasoning. The 50% bar can be extended. That's what the full sentence is. It doesn't stop with a full stop. It said that beyond 50%, it should be the reasonable justification is 50%, but subject to the conditions, specific conditions, if certain classes or castes or whatever the formula is, proved that they are backward, it can be relaxed beyond 50%. So, elite of this country, who are speaking, who are having space on the back, should talk about the complete sentence, not 50%.
Sir, my submission is you are absolutely right. But in reality, what has happened is it has become a ceiling. Except in Tamil Nadu, one or two cases, it has become a ceiling. Secondly, the other 50% has become a reserved category for the general category.
No, sir, but now
the North Indian universities, every non-general is put into the 50%, and 15, 10%, 12% are getting 50%. So the cutoff marks for general category is much lower than for OBC, SC, ST in most North Indian universities. So we are looking at the real operation of that. Nobody is going to read the whole sentence. But Justice Chinnapalladi's point is the entire sentence is unconstitutional and illegal. There is no legal basis to write it. It has created a lot of confusion. But I agree with you, but that's not helping us. We have to get rid of that whole sentence. Thank you very much for this great opportunity. So the Nayas are trying to say they are really Kshatriya. The Yadavs are trying to say we are really Kshatriya. The four Varnas, the fourth Varna, as we all know, Shudra. They are part of the Chaturvarnya system. People like us are outside it. We are Avarnas. We are Panchamas. All of us are Panchamas. We are not Shudras. So we are trying, if we make an alliance with people who are inside the Chaturvarnya structure, they've already been part of it. Now their idea is to kick out the number 1, 2 and 3 and become the number 1. And then make us their followers. But that ideology will still be maintained by them. So if we give them reservations, they will use reservations to come to power and rule us. Whereas we come from a tradition of spiritual anarchy and spiritual democracy. Our main problem is we don't want to rule anyone, we don't want to be ruled by anybody. We want freedom, we want independence. We want others to have freedom and others to have independence. So ideologically we are different. So these people who accepted the lowest position in the Chaturvarnya system, this is all political recognition. If you take EMS Namudri part, and you take Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Kashmiri Pandit, they don't look like they come from the same genetic background, right? But they're both Brahmins. Why? Because EMS Namudri Pai came from the same family record, same background as all of us. But that family somehow got accommodated into the Chaturvarnya system and declared to be recognized as a Brahmin, like promoted IAS officers and all that. They got the status, right? But once they get that, they get a vested interest in that. So I think we have to give a choice to these Shudras. Are you against the ideology of rule and subjugation and subordination and hierarchy? If you are, fine, come with us. Fight that battle to restore India to the ancient system of there being democracy. As Dr. Ambedkar said in his November 25, 1949 speech, there was a time when India had a great democracy. our constitution and his constitution, and our effort is to take us back to that democracy. And these Shudras who are part of that project, they are welcome. If they are not part of that project, then we cannot allow them to use Ambedkar's reservations to subjugate us. And you know, and they are, in some states, they are using that. They are getting power and they are subordinating and subjugating everyone else. And simply trying to prove themselves to be, they're spending money on research to prove their Kshatriyas. And so on. So that's why I'm saying we forget all this and we move forward to a new society. Sir, only two quick points. One is contempt of court and treason. Is it not anti-democracy? I agree, it is anti-democracy. It is anything that is not violent, well recognized all over the world, should be allowed, should be permitted. Anything short of violence. So your freedom can be restrained only if it interferes with someone else's freedom. So yes, these are colonial laws that a democracy should not have, and one of our, see, our responsibility now is to really proselytize and spread democracy, the culture of democracy in every aspect. And part of that is to get rid of these laws from our law books. But without there being a change of this elite oligarchy ruling us, it will not happen. So yes, I agree with this question. What would be the role of an Indian in strengthening the ideology of the constitution is exactly what I said. We must understand it in detail, every provision of the constitution, and we must spread it through all aspects of our life, including in our own homes. The way we treat our women, the way we treat our children must be democratic, must be based on equality and freedom. If we have patriarchy in our homes, we cannot go outside our homes and demand democracy in the public space. So the spirit of equality, the spirit of freedom, the spirit of dignity must become truly internalized in our lives, and respect for everyone. As I said, equality being a recognition of the infinite potential in every human being that is equal, regardless of their economic or social condition. That is what we must recognize as the basis of equality. My time is done, it's exactly 1:15.
Sorry?
Yes, sir.
So how can we see it? I am asking this about.
Yes, yes, sir. The judiciary is like a knife or a sword. You know, you can, it depends on who holds it and what purpose it is used for.
And what is ordinary?
So therefore, what swings the judiciary in your, for the people? I agree with you. Judiciary is used generally for the powerless, against the powerless, to protect the powerful. We must turn it and use it to protect the powerless against the powerful. To do that, we need an ideology. The judiciary's swing is driven by the ideology of the constitution or the ruling ideology. What Ambedkar has given us is a ruling ideology which is very pro-people. Many parts of it, part 3, part 4, preamble, very, very strongly protecting the people. That ideology can and must be used like it was used by Krishna, who was a Brahmin, but not a Brahminist. He belonged to a particular varna, but he was not a Brahminist, and he used that that ideology to give huge advantages to all of us. So therefore, I think the emphasis on ideology. We must get people like you must become judges, and you must use that constitution and that ideology to protect the people and their freedom and their rights. And that is possible, and that's what I mean by saying we must democratize the judiciary.
The majority, on behalf of the majority judges in Desi Sani case, Justice Jagan Mohan Reddy said that the 50% is not the bar exactly. What he said is subjected to the specific reasoning. The 50% bar can be extended. That's what the full sentence is. It doesn't stop with a full stop. It said that beyond 50%, it should be, the reasonable justification is 50%, but subject to the conditions, specific conditions, if certain classes or castes or whatever the formula is proved that they are backward, it can be relaxed beyond 50%. So, elite of this country, who are speaking, who are having space on the back, should talk about the complete sentence, not 50%.
Sir, my submission is you are absolutely right. But in reality, what has happened is it has become a CV. Except in Tamil Nadu, one or two cases, it has become a CV. Secondly, the other 50% has become a reserved category for the general category.
Yes, 85%.
No, sir, but now 50% in the North Indian universities, every non-general is put into the 50% and 15, 10%, 12% are getting 50%. So the cutoff marks for general category is much lower than for OBC, SC, ST in most North Indian universities. So we are looking at the real operation of that. Nobody is going to read the whole sentence. But Justice Chinnapuradi's point is the entire sentence is unconstitutional and illegal. There is no legal basis to write it. It has created a lot of confusion. But I agree with you, but that's not helping us. We have to get rid of that whole sentence. Thank you very much for this great opportunity.